So after 3 months of lecturing here, and like one serious one, I've decided that it's time to do it, and I think I might even get Ben approval for a little bit. So, all right, here we go. For the thousands in attendance and the millions at home, are you ready to rumble?
Woo!
Exactly. Yeah, all right, that's it. Strategic ideas. And instead of me making effort to present something, this dude that actually he might even come to the chess lab at some point to lecture or have like a week of a workshop, Grandmaster Haggard, that wrote some of the best books out there and amazing topics, and he's a strong grandmaster. Well, he's not playing that much anymore, but a very decent grandmaster. And I mean, all the credit to Jacob Haggard. Actually, I can even say that when he spoke to Alex here, he said actually that I presented some of the stuff in a not bad way. So that's it, you know? I take it. I'm not taking back. I give him more than full credit that he deserves. And if someone wants, you know, and he even gets like a free advertisement. They are great books. If someone wants, they're advanced. If someone wants to buy them, you know, they are really great. So this is chapter 3 in his book. And basically, we will think together. Well, mainly you will think, and I know it, so I'll pretend that I know how to read English, and that's what the book says. So it's you get the hard job. But prophylaxis, which means, well, let's prevent, think what the opponent wants to do, right? And let's see if we can prevent his ideas or some of his ideas. I mean, we just spoke before in the previous class about how chess really works. Chess doesn't work in the sense of I want to checkmate you and going to checkmate the opponent. No. It also doesn't work in the sense of, oh, wow, my opponent's going to checkmate me, run away for cover, you know, run away. No. Chess works in the following way. Well, what are my ideas? What are my opponent ideas? Who has faster and stronger ideas? And who should react? Should I continue with my plan? Or should I stop my opponent's plan? That's what chess is, right? If you are threatening checkmate in 2 moves, and your opponent is threatening checkmate in 3 moves, well, you should not blink. You will play your move. And if he will continue with his plan, your next move is going to be checkmate. So your opponent is the one that should be blinking. But on the other hand, if you see wow, you have a great combination, you might checkmate your opponent in 4 moves. He's checking you in 3 moves. Well, you better be the first one to stop him. So it's always about your play versus your opponent play. It's a simple game. White, black, you, your opponent. You are in plus, your opponent in minus. Your opponent in plus, you are in minus. What good for you, bad for him. What bad for you, good for him. Very, very simple. Well, to play is complicated. Now, we are playing here white. This position came from which opening? Let's assume that if we see no C and no D pawn, maybe it came from Sicilian. E4, at some point D4 was played. Okay. So now, if we have to look at this position, we will say this. I will go a few of the positions with you. Well, white has tiny bit more power in the center. His king is safer, already castled and moved. He has tiny bit control of the open file. Black, on the other hand, has pair of bishops, which potentially can be mamma mia strong bishops. Like, no, there are some diagonals here. And black king is stuck in the center. Well, right now black is 2 moves away from castling. This is what's happening here. You are white. So the question is, and by the way, if at some point I stop breathing here, it's because it's like the AC is like at 90 degrees behind me. So I'm just waiting for the point where, you know, it will be impossible to breathe anymore. Okay, I'll finish this. And I'm just warning you that if I'm like here, it's nothing happened. It's not the position, just no oxygen. No, it's okay. It's actually, Right? Okay, you see, I wasn't joking. Well, I chose actually how to say it, the less threatening situation, that I will just fall here collapsing dead because of the heat. The other situation was that I'm going to start taking the shirt in 2 minutes. So I started first with the dead, not to be threatening. Yes. So, apparently, thanks to Ben, what happened? Don't tell.
I had to press confirm or something stupid like that. Didn't do anything.
Oh, I see. That's a magic button over there. All right. So the bishop cannot move because checkmate here. But what does black want to play? Like, speak in lines. Forget about moves. What black want to do here? Speak. So what black want to do here?
D5.
That's a move. But why D5? I mean, D5 what? I will take D5. D5 is anti what you want to do. Your king is stuck in the center. Your king is stuck in the center. You want to open the center?
Remove the black bishop and castle.
Remove the black bishop and castle, right? I mean, you're in the middle of a field, like, you know, under some shelter. Everyone is pointing at you, and you say, well, I want to run. We're in the field. No, you'll be shot, dead, open. No, you want to, you know, get out of the middle, the center, into some reasonable shelter. Well, castling. So, first thing, that's excellent. Black wants to get the bishop out and castle. Simple, right? King, king, king in the center, out. All right. So now, what should we be thinking? How can white? Thank you. That's it. My job is done. Like, we're going to finish this puzzle. Like, bishop d4. Okay. This is a game I think of Nigel Short. Played a world championship match with Kasparov in 93, beat Karpov in a match before that, beat Jan Timan, top 10 player in the world through decent part of the 90s, late 80s, still a very strong grandmaster these days, 20 years after that, for about quarter century, like really, well, top of the world, and just today is just a very strong grandmaster. But yeah, so we can play those moves because, you know, there's no magic. It's not like they can, it's just they think faster than us many times and can understand deeper ideas. But the concept of, hey, my opponent won a castle, I want to keep his king in the center. So if I'm not mistaken, f6 was played here. And now, let's see what the book says. The most important feature of this position is that black hasn't yet managed to develop his pieces and bring his king to safety. We can establish that. I mean, Haggard is great, but he's telling us what we should know ourselves. With a simple move, white makes this very difficult to accomplish, and he has already half won the game. Bishop d4. Simple, but deeply annoying. Usually about myself, I just hear the deeply annoying, not the simple part, but okay, it just seems so familiar, like, okay, like I, all right. F5, bishop e7 gives black decent counterplay. The two bishops will have an effect in the long run. Okay, f6. So, now black is going to move the bishop and castle, right? We cannot stop it, but what we can do, go after him when he castles. So, boom, g4 and g5. And white got like really strong attack and went on to win the game. Okay, not impossible. I mean, okay, bishop d4 is a very, very nice move and so on, but not impossible. All right. Let's look at one other position. We will make effort to describe it step by step. Ivanchuk against Lars Bo Hansen. Ben Feingold. Yes. Okay, this is the game of Ivanchuk, one of the favorite dudes out there, against Lars Bo Hansen, a decent dude, but one of the favorite writers, right? He wrote some great books. Now, what's happening here? Let's assume it's white to move. let's speak about this position. Because if, seriously, if we speak, preferably in the game, quietly in your head. But let's see. There is a pin here, right? Pin. What do we want to do when we are pinning the opponent piece? Put more pressure, right? Put more pressure. Excellent. So rook e1 is an excellent move. Putting more pressure on the pin, right? And what shall black play after rook e1? Here, rook e1.
Knight takes knight.
Knight takes knight, check. Almost. And maybe e5, something like that. Somehow, by the way, I prefer white here, but yeah, also Ben. A bishop goes somewhere, but okay, maybe tiny, maybe not so clear. So, we want to put pressure, but knight take f3. And that's why we should play a grandmaster move that was even seen by grandmaster here.
I need to give them more hints.
Okay, it's one. It's something that involves the first rank, and the king moves. That's a good hint, Ben?
Uncastle?
King h1.
Yes.
Very subtle.
Basically, all white is saying is, dude, this pin is annoying, deeply annoying. Remember it from the... And I'm not going to allow you to untangle from that pin, to get out of it. That's all. So you are not thinking about only what you want to do. Yeah, what you want to do, rook e1, excellent. Well, what the opponent will do? Standard clap, yay, got. No, it's going to take and break the pin. So you're preventing from breaking the pin. And at some point, like f6, at some point c4 was, almost. c4 was played, I don't remember if it was exactly immediately f6 or another move, but basically, Ivanchuk did what he usually does to those players, like, yeah. What?
To those players.
Yeah. No, I mean, dude, with them, like, I mean, it's like, that's amazing. Like, going to this Capablanca Memorial, winning it, like, I don't know, 8 times out of 7 or something. Like, no, just winning all those. Problem is that he's coming and playing with the other dudes. He's not winning so much. Why to play? Knight a5, knight c6. Okay, what does black want to play? Now seriously, castle was played in the game.
Really?
No, not super, not really strong players.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and bishop c6, and black is okay. I mean, that's it. You exchange the fianchetto bishop, right? White's most the Catalan bishop, right? That doesn't matter if it's that's the bishop that in those positions is like everything, cutting the board, you know, you name it. So. Avuch analyzed this position, and therefore white has played. B5, with the big idea, if bishop c6, take on c6. It's a very good idea. And then he has some analysis if this here, here, and here, and white's better. I mean, okay, not really. Important to analyze it much deeper, but very simple move. If you really understand what your opponent wants to play, your opponent has no space, need to exchange pieces. Okay, so he's going to play bishop c6. So you're going to prevent him, and well, he's kind of stuck over there. I will allow the audience and Ben Feingold to think here. What?
Not Ben.
Who to move? Why to move? First, we need to understand what's happening here. I have no clue. That's why Ben's here. Seriously, Ben, do you want to have like they show in the TV, a guest appearance? You know, special guest appearance show. Like the concentration on Ben Feigl's face. Any thoughts what you would play here, Ben? Yes.
I have to look at it forever.
But so you already have an idea? Does it involve a pawn move? Does it involve the piece move? Okay, which move, Ben?
I'm looking at King D1.
King D, there's such an idea, yeah. I would never think about that. I mean, I don't know what to play in this position, but okay, let's see. You were right on, 100% on.
Ooh.
And what strategically, white is winning here. Strategically. I mean, if white is castle, I mean, okay. If this is the position, for example. Okay, strategically, it's over. I mean, what? This is basically kind of equal to a piece. I mean, b4 pawn is gone, blockade. I mean, it's I don't know what computer say here. Should be +2 or something. Like, let's just put ICC computer for a second. Yeah, okay. No, not really. Yeah, over. Like Ben said, over. Right. You know now who is my new hero for imitations. That's it, I should do Magnus. Like, if you see how he analyzed, did you see it right? Like, okay, so here, the B pawn, like, first stage, imitate how he does it. Second stage, imitate how he plays. You have to start somewhere.
Yeah, I can't even do how he does this.
No, like, okay, +3 is not bad. So, if castle, over. But there is a problem to castle. That's the problem. If bishop d3 or e2, doesn't matter, bishop h3. If bishop g2, bishop a6. This is a game where when the area when me and Ben Tiny play chess. Actually, it's kind of unbelievable. I kind of stopped playing chess this year, you know, Ben? Which year you think it was? It's incredible. Yeah.
95?
Unbelievable! Razovayev Sveshnikov 1995, this game. Exactly. Made the GM somewhere.
Based on what you said, I want to change my move.
Exactly. No, because, you know, 95, okay.
Yeah, that was really hard to find.
Oh my gosh. No, amazing. Never find it, never played. But once you tell someone, oh, I want a castle, yeah, then it's easy, right? But King D1, by the way, is a very decent move. Amazingly enough. No, amazing. I would never think about that. Maybe I would find H4.
No, that's because you're saying what some crazy moves.
No, but King D... No, computer is... King D1 is one of the first movies... let's see. I mean, I remember I looked at that. Okay. Ben will say that this is the movie he was thinking, H4. But
after you explained it,
then. But King D1, look. I mean, that's no joke.
We can't see that, so I don't know what it says.
It says 0024Y02. I mean, it's a move. It's a move in chess. But yeah, look at how to get to such idea. Exactly by, okay, first of all, really strong, and like I said, important, really strong Russian grandmasters. And in 95, it was worth something. Razovayev. So, he wants to castle. Because he knows if he castles, he's in the great words of Grandmaster Spielman. If white castles, then he is. What's that, Ben? What would Spielman...
I heard Spielman every day for 5 days in the last month.
Seriously, why?
London.
Oh, but okay. So how many times has he used the word happy bunny?
Not as much as you.
No, I use it because of him.
How
would I know about happy bunnies if not for Spielman? Happy bun. So, H4, yeah, but H4 is a result only of extremely deep understanding of the position. You want a castle, anywhere you move the bishop, D4 was played, and now he doesn't need to take the pawn and get in problem with the king in the center, whatever. Well, he played bishop here, and D4 is maybe not best move, but that's just...
He could still stop him from castling with bishop H3, but it's a
piece sack. It's a piece sack.
But it stops him from castling.
That's not bad. Huh.
That's really deep.
Deep pride. Right. No, this is a great one. By the way, I'll just show one position that I'm not even totally agreeing that is correct. No, that's amazing. But, I mean, Haggard really, really likes this move. But the next position, Ay. I'm not certain. And not bad players, right, Ben? I mean, Karjakin against Kramnik.
They're okay. Yeah, here we go.
Wait,
are you saying that Kramnik was white?
Black.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. Okay. Kramnik was black.
Yeah.
I don't know. This idea bothers me. You know, I'm... Okay. After I will finish my extremely hard work and duties in the St. Louis Chess Club, I can maybe go and take half an hour and seriously analyze this position, or 1 hour. So it's white to play. Ben Feigl, ladies and gentlemen. So basically, they're saying that this bishop, no good. No good. And they want to put bishop here. No, and Haggard get like so, like, wow. Happy bunny, Spielman times happy bunny. I mean, I don't know. I would think about like something. Knight defold. But basic bottom line. The bishop should be on g7, even sacrificing d6, but putting lots of pressure. So Karjakin played h4. And no counterplay. Do you totally buy this, Ben? This idea of this? Maybe, but I don't know. If I had a dark color bishop, I understand it a bit more, but... I mean, I...
If I'm black, I wouldn't be happy.
Wouldn't be happy, dear?
Because I wanted to play bishop g7.
No, okay, you stop bishop g7, but... Okay, it's like, I'm not certain how exactly to go after. I mean, b5, a5... Yeah, I guess so. I mean... But that's basically the idea. Too deep for me. But actually, again, h4. Apparently, it's h4, just big ideas.
Always play
h4. By the way, it's a bit crazy. Like now, in all the Timmy G against the Grunfeld, doesn't matter what, he throws h4. Like, you remember Svidler Nepomniachtchi in the Russian Championship? You just play h4, like any line, any position, any move order. Don't know what they have with this h4. Okay. You know, I'm going to put a position here. I'm going to be quiet, not saying a word. Black to play. I mean, they're okay. That's easy. Ben will find it.
Yeah.
Of course. Dot dot dot, like to move.
B4 on B4.
Illegal.
B5.
Legal.
So B5 out of the back.
B5, attacking the rook. Okay, rook moves. Rook C2.
Well, what about
doesn't
ESS?
Really
okay, you know, we're going to put it to a vote. Ben, you don't say a move.
Okay.
Yes, move for black. Pawn b5, attacking the rook. Excellent move. Nikki, what do you play?
Initially I said pawn b5, but then I thought about king f6 to get in between those pawns there.
In between the pawns.
I have to interject.
No,
I'm not going to say any move.
Yes?
Interject. Okay, there's a point to this lecture. The point of the lecture...
What is it?
The point of the lecture is your opponent wants to do stuff, and you don't want them to do stuff. So stop thinking about what you want to do. Start thinking about what they want to do, and then don't let them do it.
That's what we said, like, in any position.
B5, rook A8, king F6, because you guys want to do stuff. Stop thinking about that. Think about what you
want to do. Exactly. That's what we were saying in all the positions. We started with the first... I'll show you the first position that we started after it. That was the first 5 minutes. What the opponent want to do, what he wants to play, what's this, what's this.
It was so long ago, they forgot.
It was 40 minutes ago.
Yeah. I wasn't here, but I remember.
Yeah.
They want to march the A pawn down and queen.
Well, okay, they want ice water in hell too, but it's not going to happen.
I don't
so, see
any other
move.
B3. I mean H3.
H3. Oh, loving GM. So, why H3, Nikki?
So that, I don't know why. So that those pawns can't be connected to H3.
Pawns cannot be
And then the king.
It traps the king.
Yeah, the king can't go have as many. Yeah, no.
Then you're a king off.
Okay, for everyone here, I'm just going to read what it says here. We should never miss ideas as simple as this one. Black has the chance to trap the white king in the corner for a long time. Eternity, for example, is a long time.
Yeah.
H3. Rook C2.
Yeah, now black's a king ahead.
Yeah, exactly.
So king F6 was a good idea after the fact. Yeah.
See. King F6! Yeah, exactly. At this point, it's hard to understand why black retained from king d4, which was just winning. And he won on move 102. I can't believe how the game lasted for more than 5 moves.
Well, he's making himself
102, I mean, this is move like 33. They played 70 more moves. I don't know, you just bring the king, somehow sacrifice here. Okay, oh, we need to be careful there. Pretty much, you know the level that people only think about their moves. Like we said it before, the right way is not, okay, I'm going to checkmate my opponent, so I have to continue with my plan, or my opponent's going to checkmate me, so I have to stop it. I said it before, so I'll say it again for Ben. It's about our plans versus our opponent's plans and what we should do. I mean, if, for example, if b5 wasn't just attacking the rook on c4, let's say that there is a knight on a4, okay, b5 is winning a piece immediately, I don't need to fool around with h3. But b5 is a meaningless move. I mean, maybe it's okay, and then play h3. But what is this attack? Nikki, you were in the previous class, right? What did we say? There are threats, and there are threats. Mm-hmm. Just attacking a piece, and the piece has 65 squares to go, doesn't mean anything. Right?
Yes.
Bughouse. Doesn't mean anything. You attack a piece, and it has endless amount of squares to go. You want to create threats that are not easily prevented. That's what a threat is. Not, oh, I attack your rook. Okay, yippee. So, once we pass that stage of thinking, okay, I'll just play my threat, I just have my idea. Well, then what Ben said is, it's we opponents. So, if we can stop his plan, many times it's more valuable than continuing with our plan.